بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We'll start the second part of this talk, and it is concerned with the role of CT in assessment of abdominal lesions, and we will discuss how to examine the abdomen by CT and what are the anatomic details of the abdominal organs, and also how can you reach the common diagnostic possibilities in a simple way. Then you know that we have many imaging modalities for examination of the abdomen, and the most commonly used are the ultrasound and CT scan, less common the MRI and other techniques. Then we used to deal with any part to be examined by CT in four aspects. The first one, why do we examine this part by CT? How can we prepare the patient for this examination? How can we produce the images, and how can we interpret the images? There are many indications for examination of the abdomen by CT. And the most common one and the most important one, in my opinion, is to assess an equivocal imaging finding. And you all know that many patients are examined by ultrasound, and there are a lesion. There is a lesion that cannot be fully diagnosed and needs further verification. Then there comes the role of CT scan. Assessment of liver and biliary problems is one of the important tasks of CT. Also, the diagnosis of abdominal masses and the workup of primary malignancies extra-abdominal. Also, assessment of vascular lesions and cases with abdominal trauma. Then, to examine the patient by CT for the abdomen, we used to give the patient some oral contrast. And this oral contrast is known as gastrographin, and this gastrographin is given to the patient diluted. The aim of oral intake of gastrographin is to opacify the bowel, so that if you take sections in the abdomen, you can easily differentiate between the bowel and any other abnormal masses inside the abdomen. Like this one, for example. And in this patient with lymphoma, you can see the lymphomatous lesions inside the abdomen clearly demarcated from the normal bowel loops. If you do not give the patient contrast material, then you are not able to discriminate between the unopacified bowel and the diseased bowel. Also, in this case you have seen few minutes ago, you see a lesion. And this lesion, if you do not give the patient contrast orally, you will not see this contrast passing inside the mass. Then you cannot exactly determine the origin of this mass. But if you see a bowel loop running through the mass itself, then you know that this mass should be of bowel origin. Then you reach the diagnosis. If it is a small bowel, most likely it is lymphoma. If it is a large bowel, most likely it is a colonic carcinoma. Then after you prepare the patient by the oral contrast, you order him to fast for 4 to 6 hours, because you are going to inject him with intravenous contrast material as well. Then the patient came, lies in the supine position on the machine, and you do this image. And this image is known as the scanogram, or the scout view, or the preliminary image. The main value of this image is to let the machine know where you are going to start and to finish. Then you draw a line here and a line there. The machine knows that you are going to scan this area from this line down to this line. Then the machine or the computer asks the operator, the scanning interval at what? Do you like to scan this area every 1 centimeter section, or half a centimeter section, or 3 millimeter section, according to the needs of the examination and the diagnosis of the patient. Then you start to get images, and you see this is the image obtained. And you see here, this is the liver, and this is the stomach filled with contrast material, and this is the spleen, and you can see the aorta here. Then you continue until you finish the whole abdomen. And At a time, we used to get the patient prepared and lying supine, do the scanogram, injecting him with contrast material, and do the scan, let him go to home. But after that, we developed we improved the examination quality by taking a pre-contrast scans. Before we inject the patient with contrast material, we take sections for the abdomen. And the reason for this is, you see these images. These are two cut images in the abdomen, and this is without contrast because the aorta is not stained with contrast. And this is after injection of contrast because the aorta is stained with contrast material. Then in this area, in this liver, you cannot see any pathology. But if you go back to the non-contrast image, you can see a lesion here, and another lesion here, another lesion here, another lesion here. What is the reason for this? If you injected the patient with contrast, you may have a chance that the lesion and the liver parenchyma take the contrast material equally. Then you cannot see the lesion. So we started to perform a pre-contrast study for the liver in particular, to look for the lesions that may enhance exactly like the liver parenchyma. Then we reach this situation. This is an examination without contrast material. The aorta is empty of contrast. And this is the examination with contrast material, and the aorta is stained with contrast. The liver, as you see, is markedly enlarged. And if you look carefully in the liver, you may see a focal lesion here, you can see. And you may suspect another one here. And if you go to the liver after injection of contrast material, you can predict two or three lesions here. But if you look to this image, and you can see how many lesions are located in the liver parenchyma, they are many. And you can see this one, this one, this one, so many lesions are located in the liver. Why these lesions are apparent? Because we imaged the liver while the contrast is in the artery. You see the aorta here, what is the difference between the contrast here and here? This is the concentrated contrast material because we developed the more faster CT machines. And you all know that the liver disease, the liver masses are supplied by the hepatic artery. And the normal liver parenchyma is supplied by the portal vein. Then in order to see the hepatic pathology, you should scan the liver while the contrast is in the artery. This is what we call the arterial phase. Then you may scan the liver later on while the contrast is in the artery and vein as well. This is known as the venous phase. And later on, you scan the liver two or three minutes later, and this is the delayed phase. Then you got a scan which is known as the triphasic study of the liver, which is the essential or the mandatory examination for detection of any liver pathology nowadays. There is no way to detect liver lesions accurately without this study, which is known as the triphasic study. How can you know the triphasic study when you are looking at the film? Just look to the aorta. If the aorta is as bright as the bones, then you know that there is the maximum contrast inside the aorta, and this is the arterial phase. You should ensure that you have an arterial phase, which is very important to look for the hepatic pathology. And if you look to this patient, do you think this patient is injected with contrast or not?
No.
Not. Look to the aorta. Yes. You can see some contrast in the aorta and in the upper pole of the right kidney, for example. And they look to the difference. This is the upper bowl of the kidney, which is markedly enhanced, and the aorta is almost similar to the bone. Then this is the arterial phase, and this is the delayed phase. Look at this lesion, and this lesion is hardly seen in this study, but is well seen in the arterial phase. That's why you should obtain this arterial phase in order to accurately diagnose any hepatic focal lesion or diffuse pathology. Then we'll go through the anatomy of the abdomen, and you know that this is the liver, and this is the spleen, this is the stomach, and here this is the aorta. If you go down, you can see this is the liver, this is the spleen, this is the aorta, this is the IVC, and this is the stomach, which is filled with the orally introduced contrast material. And here you can see the start of the pancreas, and this is the body and the tail of the pancreas. And if you look to the aorta, you see a strip here and another strip here. And this is the diaphragmatic crura. The left cross is thinner compared to the right diaphragmatic cross. This is the aorta and this is the IVC. This is the right kidney, this is the left kidney, this is the spleen, and this is the pancreas. If you go down, then you see the liver, this is the gallbladder. And this is the kidney, and this is the right kidney, this is the aorta, crura of the diaphragm, IVC, and bowel loops. Then if you go down, then you see the left kidney, the right kidney, and this is the aorta, and you see the left renal vein crossing the midline anterior to the aorta to join the inferior vena cava. Then if you look carefully in this particular area, you see bowel loops, but you see this structure, which is the pancreatic head. How can you know that this is the pancreatic head? By these two anatomic landmarks. There are two small dots. One is smaller than the second, and this is the artery, this is the vein, the superior mesenteric artery and the superior mesenteric vein. Then if you look here, this is the pancreatic head because this is the superior mesenteric artery and this is the superior mesenteric vein. And if you look inside the pancreatic head, you will find the small black dot, which is the common bile duct. Okay? Then you go more down, the kidney, the aorta, the IVC, rest of the liver, and multiple bowel loops as well as the pancreatic head. If you go more down, you do not see the pancreas anymore. This is the left kidney, right kidney, part of the liver, it's a small intestinal and large intestinal loops. Then go down, this is the aorta, this is the IVC, and this is the spine, this is the psoas muscle, and you can see the small and large bowel loops. More down, the pelvis, and you see here the small and large bowel, and you see also the intrapelvic fat. You go more down, and you still see some of the colonic and the small bowel loops, and you can see here this is the iliopsoas muscle, this is the iliac bone, and whenever you go more down, if you are dealing with a male pelvis, you will see this is the renal bladder, these are the seminal vesicles, and this is the rectum. Lower down, you can see this is the prostate, and this is the remaining part of the renal bladder, and this is the rectum. And here you can see the prostate, no more urinary bladder, and the pelvic floor muscles. But if you are dealing with a female pelvis, you know that the uterus is above the urinary bladder. The cervix is present between the urinary bladder and the rectum. Then you see here, this is the uterus, and this is the intestinal loops, and this is the urinary bladder, and this is the rectum. Then this part should represent the cervix of the uterus. Then we say some few details about each organ we have mentioned. You know that the liver has two lobes, left and right. The left and right lobe are discriminated by a line which connects the inferior vena cava to the gallbladder. Then this line separates between the left lobe and the right lobe. The left lobe is further divided into two segments by the fissure 4 ligamentum teres. And this is the lateral segment which is away from the liver. And this is the medial segment which is near to the rest of the liver. And here is the right lobe is divided by a transverse line from the inferior vena cava into the anterior segment and the posterior segment. Then you can see the pancreatic tail and body. And this is the spleen, this is the aorta, the diaphragmatic crura, on both sides. Then you look to the liver, it is homogeneous. There is no filling defects. But if you perform a CT scan and you see this filling defect, which is cystic, means it contains something like water. And this is another filling defect, which is solid, means it is almost similar to the hepatic parenchyma. Then you have cystic lesions and solid lesions. In radiology, we usually consider cystic lesions are benign and solid lesions are malignant. Then we have four benign lesions in the liver that are cystic. Number one is hydatid cyst. Number two, four, abscess, yes, hydatid cyst, abscess, whether biogenic or amoebic. Number three, simple cyst. Number four, hemangioma, which is the most common, the most common. Hemangioma is not exactly a cystic lesion, but it appears in the images as a cystic pathology, okay? These are the four common cystic benign lesions in the liver, with one exception, which is cystic but malignant, which is the biliary cyst adenocarcinoma. Four malignant lesions in the liver that are common, number one, hepatocellular carcinoma, number two, metastasis, number three, cholangiocarcinoma, number four, lymphoma, yes, lymphoma. And the benign solid lesion in the liver, which is the focal nodular hyperplasia. Do you hear about focal nodular hyperplasia? It's not that common. Okay. What do you think about these lesions, benign or malignant? Benign, yes. And these lesions, solid lesions, they are malignant. Okay. Then if you look to the liver should be exactly similar to the spleen and the density. If the liver is slightly darker than the spleen, then the liver may contain fat. And this is the way we diagnose fatty liver. Fat may be little or may be severe fatty infiltration of the liver. And you got more darkness of the liver compared to the density of the spleen. When the liver is black compared to the spleen or darker compared to the spleen, then you can diagnose fatty liver. And this diagnosis is easy. This is a cirrhotic liver. You see the liver is shrunken with irregular outline. The spleen is enlarged. But if you look here, you can see this patient is injected with contrast or not. No, the aorta is black. Okay, then what is the appearance of the liver in relation to the spleen? The liver is more brighter than the spleen. Then whenever you see in the non-contrast study that the liver is denser than the spleen, then some of these diseases has should be considered, like glycogen storage disease, hemochromatosis, hemosiderosis, and any material that is added to the liver parenchyma elevated its density compared to the spleen. And if you look to the liver, you should not see any black lines inside the liver. If you see black lines inside the liver, you know that these are dilated biliary radicals. And dilated biliary radicals, this is an example, you see? These are dilated biliary radicals. Because the normal bile ducts are not usually seen by CT. But if you see dense tracts or dense lines passing through the liver, these are vessels. And the vessels in the liver are three, the hepatic artery, the hepatic vein, and the portal vein. You know that the hepatic artery will not be seen unless you have an arterial phase. Then if you look to the aorta, which is very dense, this is the arterial phase, then these branches are the branches of the hepatic artery. And the hepatic veins are only seen in one section, where the inferior vena cava is in its fossa on the surface of the liver. Is intimately related to the visceral surface of the liver. Then you see three branches entering the inferior vena cava that are the superior, middle, and the inferior hepatic veins. Any branch other than these two is considered one of the portal venous radicals. And this is what we call CT portography, where you can inject some contrast material intravenously and image the portal venous circulation. This is the portal vein, this is the portal radicals inside the liver, and this is the splenic vein, this is the superior mesenteric vein, and this is the spleen. And by this way, we can easily diagnose any abnormalities in the portal system. Like this case, you see the liver is cirrhotic, the spleen is markedly enlarged, and there are dilated tortuous vessels at the lower oesophageal region representing oesophageal varices. And here you see the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein, the portal vein with a big thrombus inside the portal vein. Then if you look to the porta hepatis, you can see some fat and you can see the portal vein, because you cannot see the hepatic artery unless you have an arterial phase. You cannot see the common bile duct unless it is dilated. Then the only one which can be identified in the porta hepatis is the portal vein. And if you go back to the anatomy, you can easily say that this liver is fatty because it is slightly darker than the spleen. And you can say that this is the aorta, this is the IVC, and this is the diaphragmatic crura on the left, and this is the diaphragmatic crura on the right. Then you go to the pancreas, and you know that the pancreas lies obliquely in the abdomen. Then if you are coming from up down, you will hit the pancreatic body and tail first, then you will hit the pancreatic head. But in some people, you can see this appearance of the pancreas. You can see the whole pancreas in the same section, the pancreatic tail, body, and head, because in this particular case, the pancreas lies horizontally in the abdomen. If you look at the abdomen and you see this pancreas, you see the pancreas, posterior to it, there is a vein, which is the splenic vein. And if you look to the pancreas in older people, and you can see the pancreas is infiltrated by fat, and this is normal. Normal in elderly patients, you can see the pancreas, which is infiltrated by fat, which is considered normal. It has no relation with the pancreatic function. In normal cases, you see the pancreas with clear fat around the pancreas. But here you see the pancreas, which is swollen, and the fat is congested. You see the fat is dirty, filled with opacities, which represent the congested veins, the inflammatory tissue, and in this case of acute pancreatitis. Then this is the liver, this is the spleen, this is the pancreatic tail and the body, and you can see the splenic vein. And if you look here, you can see the pancreatic head. How do you know? This is the superior mesenteric artery, and this is the superior mesenteric vein, and this is the common bile duct. Then if you look here, this vessel is the superior mesenteric vein. Very good. And this is the superior mesenteric artery, and this is the pancreatic head, and this is the common bile duct. This is the pancreatic tail, and this is the pancreatic body. And here you can see this arrow points to the superior mesenteric vein, and this is the pancreatic head, and this is the left renal vein. And in this area, this arrow also points to the superior mesenteric vein, which is thrombosed. And the normal superior mesenteric vein is homogeneously enhanced, while if there is a thrombus inside the vein, you can see a filling defect. And you can see also ascites because of thrombosis of the superior mesenteric vein. Then this liver is fatty compared to the spleen. But the aim of this image is to look for the suprarenal gland. And the suprarenal gland is above the kidney and is like the inverted Y. You see this stem and this limb and this limb. Also here, like the inverted Y, the suprarenal gland appears normally like the inverted Y above the renal bowl. And this is usually seen in cases where you have adequate retroperitoneal fat. If you don't have adequate retroperitoneal fat, as in a children or slim patients, you cannot see the suprarenal gland. But here there is an adequate fat in the retroperitoneum. You can see the left suprarenal gland, and you can see also the right suprarenal gland. If you go more down, then you see this is the psoas muscle, this is the aorta, this is the IVC, and bowel loops filled with contrast material. And look for this structure, which is filled with contrast material. This is the ureter. The ureter is seen anterior to the psoas muscle when it contains contrast material. But if it is not containing contrast material, you cannot see it. Why you don't see contrast material in the ureter? Because of the peristalsis. At a time, the peristaltic wave passes and you take the section, you don't see the ureter. Then at the relaxation time, you can see the ureter. Then in the kidney, the same as the liver. Cystic masses are benign, solid masses are malignant. And this is the appearance of a cystic mass in the kidney, which is a simple renal cyst. And this is an example of a solid mass in the kidney, which is a renal cell carcinoma. In this patient, you have the two lesions in the same kidney, a simple cyst and a renal carcinoma. And you can easily discriminate both depending on the density of the lesion. Then you know that with the recent machines of CT, you got what is known as virtual endoscopy. And that's to say you can use the camera of the machine to go inside any hollow part in the human body. And if you want to go through the colon to perform an examination which is known as virtual colonoscopy, you first prepare the patient thoroughly. You got rid of every fecal material inside the colon. Then you inject the colon with air. Then you take sections in the abdomen and to see the colon. Then you reconstruct this image for the colon which is filled with air. Then you do this. And I will hope this is work. Oh, it will not work. Okay. Can you continue? Yes. You see, like this, you just push a button on the machine, which initiates what is known as the virtual camera. Then you can move inside the image of the colon. You can move inside the image of the colon, then to see the inner aspect of the colon. And then you may reach, you are going by the camera, then you hit the colonic wall, then you change the direction of the camera and go inside this lumen, like this. You see here. Then you pass until you may see a polyp, you may see a stricture, you may see a diverticulum, you may see an ulcer. And every now and then you have to change the direction of the camera in order to see much more inside the colon until you finish the whole colon, and you may go back in the opposite direction, no problem. Okay. Then. You see, this is a barium enema, and this is the polyp inside the colon. And you perform the injected air inside the colon after adequate preparation. Then you see a colon with a small ulcer at its top, and you see it is sessile, meaning that it is a malignant polyp most likely. And this is the appearance of the polyp by virtual colonoscopy, and you see the ulcer at the tip of the polyp, and here is the polyp after being resected with ulcer and proved to be sigmoid carcinoma. Then there are few quizzes for you, not for the radiologists. And they start by number one is the liver, and number two is the stomach. Why it is not filled with contrast? Because nowadays some of the radiology centers do not give patients contrast material. They give instead water in order to save money. Okay, then what is that? The spleen, and this is the diaphragmatic cross, and this is the aorta, and here, yes, this is the tail of the pancreas, and here, gallbladder. If you say bladder, it goes to the renal bladder, and this is, yes, you should specify if there are two kidneys, you should specify that this is the left. Okay, and this is IVC, and this is, and you see here, this is the aorta and the branch coming from the anterior aspect of the aorta. There are three branches coming from the anterior aspect of the aorta: the celiac, the superior mesenteric, and the inferior mesenteric. The celiac is not seen because it is short. The inferior mesenteric is not seen because it is thin. Then the remaining part is the superior mesenteric. If you see an artery coming from the anterior aspect of the aorta, it is the superior mesenteric artery. Okay, and this is portal vein. Yes, this is the portal vein in the porta hepatis. Okay, then the splenic vein, left kidney. Portal vein, gallbladder. Bladder means urinary bladder. Gallbladder. Left suprarenal gland. Diaphragmatic crust. Tail of the pancreas. Very good. Splenic vein. Yes, this is right. The vessel posterior to the pancreas is the splenic vein. Okay, and this left renal vein crossing the anterior aspect of the aorta to join the inferior vena cava, and this is the superior mesenteric artery. Okay, then gallbladder, and this is the pelvis. Okay, urinary bladder. Which part of the uterus? Yes, this is the cervix. It's a fatal mistake to say the uterus as, or to interpret the uterus as a prostate. There's a fatal mistake in examinations in the radiology. Okay, this is the rectum. Then aorta, IVC. Yeah, this is the prostate, and this is not the cervix. This is the prostate, and you see it is deeply seated in the pelvis. Okay, left kidney, left ureter, okay, aorta. Which part of the colon? Cecum. Very good. Thank you very much.